A guru is someone who enables you to reach unprecedented levels that you could never get to by yourself. A guru is a person who shows you the path down the golden road to unlimited devotion. And once you're touched by these special gurus, you are never the same person again.
Pete Newell had one of the great minds to ever be part of the game of basketball. Pete Newell's career has extended just on so many levels that most fans aren't aware of.
Pete is an icon in our profession. He stands for everything that's good about basketball. He's one of the two or three people that has won an NCAA championship, an NIT championship, an Olympic championship, and just knows more basketball than any human living.
And I put him in probably the top five coaches that have ever coached the game of basketball. I know that Bob Knight thinks absolutely the world of him.
Well, Pete Newell's family tree, when it comes to basketball, is bigger than them all. It goes through college, it goes through the pros. And so if you meet that family, you've just tapped in to a network that you could never imagine.
Pete was a visionary basketball person who understood exactly how to put the team together. His ability to understand what made a group work as a unit was unparalleled.
The important part of his life, I think, was based upon his relationship after he got out of college, because he was constantly teaching, constantly giving of himself to, you know, to promote basketball.
Pete Newell is one of the most instrumental people in our game to have changed the game. You know, he just had a way about him that people felt not only good about him, but they felt good about themselves and what they were doing.
Coach Newell, I think, was the best teacher in the history of the game, because until his passing, he continued to study it.
Internationally, Pete's renowned because of the Olympics and because he would lecture. He would go lecture and do clinics in those various countries. Japan, he's like an icon in Japan, and he was an inspiration in more than just what he could teach in X's and O's and on the court.
For years in the NBA, I served as in different capacities, as chairman of the Competition and Rules Committee for years, as chairman of the board, as head of the expansion committee. And when it came to the game, the guy I went to was Pete Newell.
I learned very quickly that I was about to write sort of the history of basketball, because everybody I wanted to talk to, from Jerry West to Oscar Robertson to Bill Russell, it just covered the whole spectrum of what was important in both college and even pro basketball, having him work with the Lakers. I mean, he really was a man who did everything.
And any time that I ever really had a problem when I was coaching the Lakers, you know, I'd call Pete on the phone and ask him about what he thought. And he was always very gracious and very diplomatic in his responses back to me about, you know, things that he thought I should be doing.
You know, he really believed in giving back to the game. There was no better ambassador in the history of basketball. And he gave of his time. Was never about monetary value or fame or money. And yes, he had this guru, almost a Yoda-like quality late in his career that made you want to seek him out.
He was a man who had so many different titles during the course of his life, from president to general manager to coach to player himself to businessman, to athletic director, television commentator, all these different positions that he filled. And then to us, he was always just the coach.
Ladies and gentlemen, get on.
Our coach, Jimmy Needles, was a tremendously successful coach of USF. And this, of course, well before the war. And defensively, Jimmy Needles was far ahead of the game. he was talking about transition basketball when it was a word that nobody understood or even paid any attention to it.
Well, Jimmy goes way back into the 20s, and it's amazing how much he contributed to the game. He was the Olympic coach of the 1936 Olympics at Berlin. He was one of the coaches there. And then he went to Loyola and became the head coach down there.
Jimmy Needles was way ahead of the game in terms of his vision and some of the things that he would propound to us that were as foreign as could be. He was a wonderful man. He was a teaching coach. And as a result, we had a pretty good team at Loyola. We grew up on part method teaching. It's simply a breakdown of your offense to drills, a 1-on-1, 2-on-2, 3-on-3, 4-on-4, and then the 5-on-5. And Jimmy was our mentor, and having played for him like we did for the amount of time that we were involved with him, that we got such a great respect for his knowledge of the game. And every little aspect of a move, he would not only describe it to you, but he'd tell you why he used it. And he taught us how to teach the game. And incidentally, Jimmy Needles was the one that talked me into going into coaching. Jimmy Needles ended up as the business manager of USF.
And he was kind of the promoter. He lined up all the games, basketball, football, all the sports.
And the Jesuits all knew him because he had such a good reputation there in athletics.
First time I met Pete, he and Phil Wolpert walked into the Page Street gym. George Moscone and I are shooting around prior to the beginning of basketball season. And George Moscone, being a future politician, always had his ear to the ground. So he said, you know, one of those guys is going to be our coach at SI, and the other guy is going to be at USF. They're just starting out. And we looked at each other, and I said, well, one of them looks like Henry Fonda, and that was Wolpert, because we, you know, we're movie buffs. And I said, the other guy's Cary Grant. And of course, that's Pete. And we looked at each other as kids and said, I hope we get Cary Grant.
At that particular time, I got this job, and I really didn't have the credentials to get it. But Jimmy was so positive that I could do the job that he talked me into taking it. So when they hired me to be the basketball coach, actually with the walking athletic department, I was the baseball coach, the tennis coach, and the golf coach. And I was making $3,200 a year coaching all those teams.
Pete got us in such good condition that when you were playing the games, they were easy compared to practice, because practice was just tough. Everyone was just after you. And so when we played a game, boy, it was a relief.
Playing for Pete Newell was quite an experience. As time progressed, we learned more and more about ball control, defense, and our defense was a collapsing weak side defense.
Pete's the best teacher of basketball that I know of. He is so thoroughly and intensely involved. It has to do with his personality. He has a presence that makes a guy who never dove for a loose ball, in a couple of days, that guy's down on the floor, you know, scrambling for the loose ball. You know, we get this loose ball, that's a third of a basket that we have.
I was the first one to play the press defense out here. I don't know in the East. And I played it because Rennie Hararius was only about 5'6", and he's quick as the devil, and he's really good on the ball, defending, and a good quarterback for a team.
One of the drawbacks that we had, especially for recruiting, is that we didn't have a gym. And we used to have to go down to Page Street Gym on Page Street, which was about 7 blocks away from the university. All the games were at Kezar. We would eventually play some games at the Cow Palace because of the doubleheaders that they used to have out there. When we brought teams in like Bradley or CCNY, and teams of that caliber. Pete Rozelle was our sports information man. He went to all the stations, all the newspapers, and got to try to sell the USF as much as possible. And he went about a week ahead to the Garden trying to tell us how good the Dons were at that time. And Pete was brought in by by Newell. We were so fortunate to play in the Garden. That was the Mecca of basketball. If you played in the Garden, that was it. And here we are before 18,000 people playing, and the fans were just wonderful. And they kind of took to our team. In those days, they seeded four teams. And so we had to play Manhattan, the first one, and then Utah was next. And Utah, of course, had a couple of All-Americans. So we're now in the semifinals, and we play Bowling Green. We beat them by 10, and then we played in the finals against Loyola of Chicago. And they had beaten Kentucky, which had gone to the Olympics in 48. And it was really Nick and Tuck. And then it was tied, and then Cazara got fouled, but Ross, they gave Ross the shot.
So he made the foul shots, Ross, doing that NIT.
Didn't the NIT open up a lot of doors? Everyone knew about you. It was a dream.
In 1950, we were invited back again to the NIT, and we met the strongest team in the country in the first round, CCNY.
We got eliminated in the NIT on the first round by CCNY, who eventually won the tournament. And so we come back, and Pete gets a notice from Michigan State. Michigan State, at that particular time, was new to the Big Ten, and they needed a basketball coach. So they contacted Pete, and Pete talked it over with his family and accepted the job.
Pete was a California guy, and when he went back to Michigan State, he basically almost created that program. They had no basketball to speak of. He got them into respectability. They didn't win any Big Ten titles, but he put them on the map, so to speak. But he wasn't real wild about the snowstorms and the whole deal back there. And Cal made him an offer one night, and it was for all of $8,000 a year. And he was making $12,500 at Michigan State. And he told me that it was never about money. So it was more about lifestyle and what's ahead and how I can further my career. It was based on family, what would be best for us, what Florence thinks about it, and that's how Pete operated.
My first year at Cal from Michigan State, I came in with a lot of young kids that were sophomores, and the first year we only won one game in conference, and USC and UCLA were really good team. UCLA and Johnny Wooden's team they were always strong. In those days, you know, you didn't beat UCLA that many times. John brought to the West Coast a style of basketball that we'd not seen. And these young guys I had, they really wanted to play the game, and they had so much energy and so much desire. So I said, well, they'll beat us now, but before you leave here, you're going to be beating them. And I really meant it, and I really felt it.
And at that time, in the mid-50s, there were less than 100 black undergraduate students at the campus, and that's kind of the way the alumni liked it. And all of a sudden, Pete's got three black kids on his freshman team coming in. He didn't see color, and all of a sudden, he's getting a bunch of grief from alumni who he told me were just flat-out rednecks. That's how I described him. So now he's not a winning coach on the varsity. Now he's brought in some guys that the alumni aren't real wild about.
Earl Robinson was one of my guards then.
There were many individuals up there who were a bit taken back by the fact that Pete recruited three young African-American players to be on his freshman team. And as a result, the university had to make a transition in terms of how they were going to deal with that. So that was stressful for him. There were people who were probably going at him in many ways. And he was trying to get the university to understand that there was a change that was coming.
But I mean, Pete just never saw color, and he wasn't hearing from anybody to tell him differently. He knew where he was going, and nobody was going to stop him.
Pete Newell's approach to basketball would be successful in any era, at any time in the history of the game, including today, and for a number of reasons.
Every day on the court, it was a classroom. It was an extension of the greatest public university in the world. When you were on the court, you were in Pete Newell's classroom. Pete understands angles and spacing and distances and timing.
I could be practicing at the other end of the gym, and I knew that Pete was coming in the gym because I could feel the cold air that came in. Once he stepped on the floor, It was all business.
In the preseason, we did this long distance endurance training. And we would run up Newell Hill, this fire trail up in Strawberry Canyon. And it was about 180 yards long from the bottom to the top. It was really steep.
I had one of the track men, Bowden, and he would be the one that set the pace.
Don Bowden, America's first four-minute miler, would come out and run with us, and he would run with the pack, and everybody had to make it without stopping. And I mean, guys had their hands on their knees, kind of pulling their legs up, going, and people were throwing up all over the place. And it was a very, very exhilarating thing once you made it to the top of Newell Hill.
And the payoff was we beat a lot of teams in the second half because we're better conditioned.
Almost all of our shots were off motion of some sort, so it wasn't one-on-one playing, but a little bit of one-on-one. There wasn't a point guard and a shooting guard or anything like that. Guards were guards, and the forwards were forwards. So it was a very balanced offense.
I mean, we had players playing for us that couldn't jump very high, and they weren't big, well, everybody else, but they were smart, and they could cut off of people, and nobody knew what anybody was doing. Our game was continuity. You take four or five passes and we got a good shot. Layups.
Pete was always very loyal to the people that played for him. And so when the opening came, he asked me to come over to Cal.
Pete used him like a teaching assistant. Rennie was a specialist in outlining other teams and how they played.
He was involved with all the scouting. He was involved with all the teams that we played, and he set up the game plan.
And he taught us how to force people out of their game. And I think that was the real key to Cal basketball. And Pete wasn't afraid to make changes at any time, even in a timeout. And the subtleness of the changes were enough just to throw off the rhythm of the opponent.
After a game in the locker room, he could give you every play and what every player did like it was a perfect film. And he could play it back to you like a perfect and chronological order of where you were standing, where the ball was, who didn't run for it, where the screen was, and he's continued that throughout his whole life. And I think people who can play back their discipline in their mind are the greatest teachers in the world.
I equate Pete Newell to a Bill Walsh in football in terms of that creative ability to take advantage of matchups.
Most people don't know that Pete was the assistant baseball coach when we won the College World Series. Pete's strategies in terms of how we played teams and what we were able to do made it possible for us to win the championship.
One of the most famous games played on the West Coast was UCLA. And UCLA had beaten us over a period of time that was kind of embarrassing.
That was a bitter rivalry. And it took a while for Pete to get on even terms with Wooden, but it all changed in a game in 1957.
So we play this game, and I told my players that we're not going to call a timeout. I'll call a timeout, but don't expect one, because you're not going to get it.
And calling a timeout was a sign of weakness to Pete and John Wooden.
The first half, John didn't call a timeout, nor did I. And I had my guys up pressing them, not in an aggressive press, but just making them work. And so we played the second half, and we played, I think, 18 minutes, and we're even. We've been even the whole way. And suddenly they started trying to make a mistake. They made it for about 45 seconds. I think we got around 8 points.
And Pete sees a UCLA guy grabbing his shorts. Sure sign of a guy who was a little beat. And then John called the first time out. Cal won the game. They won the next seven against Wooden. And Pete wound up going 8-0. The last eight against Wooden, he won.
And of course, years later and through that time, John learned what Pete's presses did to other teams and to him.
And the players always said it went back to that game, that test of wills. And John Wooden's UCLA press went right back to Pete. One reason Pete's teams beat Wooden all those years was because they played the hell out of defense. They weren't ever a great offensive player. I don't think Pete ever had a really super talented offensive team, even when they won the 59 title.
I remember in 59, we got to Louisville, and no one in the world gave us a chance to beat Oscar in Cincinnati.
It was Louisville, Cal, West Virginia, and Cincinnati. And of course, it was the dream setup for Jerry West to play Oscar in the finals. Well, we didn't have that in our plans.
The media were based in New York, and so to them, the big schools were CCNY, NYU, St. John's, Fordham, Long Island University, et cetera, et cetera. You know, they thought basketball revolved around the East, New York and Philly.
Oscar was an incredible player. He was probably the most advanced player for his age that I'd ever played against. He could rebound, he could pass the ball, he could defend. He did all the things that I always felt were the qualifications for any great player.
Oscar's averaging 30-some a game, and we double-teamed him when he got the ball and then made him pass it off. And as a consequence, he held him to, I think, 16 or 18 points.
What really worked for us against Cincinnati was our defense and our rebounding. I think we got about 12 or 14 more rebounds than Cincinnati did.
Pete developed an offense and a defense that encouraged discipline.
In 59, without Imhoff, we would have never won it. We had the hammer at that time.
Cal in 1959 and 60, they beat us in the finals. They played very well together. You don't win without a strong bench, no matter what level you're on. You need a couple of guys coming off the bench doing something for you. We didn't have that.
The 59 championship game, we beat Oscar in the semifinals. Now we've got Jerry West.
Jerry West was a forward in college. I'd say, 6'4", 6'5", something in that level. But he could jump. I mean, he had great legs.
Cal had a very controlled offense, and, you know, they did certain things and try to make you counter. And they had good players and extremely well coached, of course.
The difference in all of those games really is Pete Newell. We had a better coach than anybody in the country.
Florence was the ultimate basketball coach's wife. Pete was so lucky to have her because she understood the game so well, understood exactly what he was doing and the magic of his career.
Florence was, she was the captain of our team, and the kids would tell you that too. She just was a wonderful woman in so many ways. And the biggest was that in coaching, it's very, very difficult for the wife because, you know, you've had a bad day of practice. Wife is living with an inhuman person, you know. I mean, he ought to be in a cage rather than out in public.
It's like dealing with Einstein every day. And Florence was like a Trojan soldier, a Spartan. She kept the four kids organized, the four boys.
And so she was the matriarch of the Newell family. The thing that I don't think most people understand is the sacrifices that basketball wives of the head coach and even assistant coaches and the mothers that they are, the important role that they play.
Pete really wasn't around to help with the kids as much as he wanted to, and you know, in the off season he'd catch up and play ball with them and like that, but during the season he was gone physically, and when he was home he was still gone. You know, as composed as he was and as educated as he was in the game and as well prepared as his teams were, all he could think about was, what's going to go wrong? Did I cover everything? Are we prepared? And it completely overwhelmed him.
He was a very intellectual man and an analytical type of mind. That's why he liked the horses. And so when we were up at Berkeley, Golden Gate Fields was nearby, and Pete invited us sometime to go over there. And so we all went over, and then's when I knew he was addicted to horse racing and how much he truly loved it. After the season was over, we'd go 2, 3, 4 times, and it didn't matter if it was sunny or if it was raining. We'd be up there making our $2 bets. He could spend hours reading the racing form, handicapping, trying to figure out who was going to win the race, and then he'd change his mind when he got to the window. And he was always trying to coach the perfect game, play the perfect race.
Well, I can remember almost like it was yesterday. I was a sophomore at the University of Illinois, and we were headed to Los Angeles to play in the LA Classic in the brand new sports arena. We were more of the run and gun Big Ten in those days, and it was more about outscoring your opponents. Illinois was 7-0, scoring over 100 points a game, and I go to Los Angeles for the first time in my life. I'm 19 years old, and we play Cal. And there was a young, good-looking coach by the name of Pete Newell. They slowed the ball down. They had the reverse action that he became so famous for as a coach, and they held us to 50 points. It was so new and different for us that you couldn't help but be impressed with what was happening on the court. He had complete control of the game. And that made a big impression on me.
By the time the brackets all come together, here's West Virginia against Cal, and it's a rematch of the 1959 NCAA championship. And this was going to be the game that they're really going to get us. Tandy Gillis holds Jerry to 8 points. We win by 20. A lot of it had to do with Tandy.
Their defense was unbelievably sound. They'd spent hours in the gym, hands up, back and forth, running up the hills. They were in great shape, they played great defense, and you know, they're winning game after game. They lost one game in 1960.
The moments that you would have, the quiet moments that you'd have with your father was really limited, you know, because there was so much demand, alumni demand, speaking appearances, recruiting.
I don't think I ever saw him eat on a game day. He'd drink coffee and smoke cigarettes, and he was incredibly thin at that time and very nervous.
The last six or seven road trips we took, everywhere we went, Pete would get a 5 to 10 minute standing ovation.
The last thing he wanted to do was go out there. He'd be hiding in some corner, just one last cigarette, one last thought about what we're going to do here.
He'd come out just before the game started, and of course the fans would give him an ovation, and he didn't really care for that.
In 1960, we lost the NCAA championship game, and it was heartbreaking. It was in the Cal Palace, Pete's last game.
Ohio State beat Cal in the 1960 title game, and Pete's regrets, none.
And finally, it came down to, with all that pressure and stuff, the doctors told him that if he wanted to live any longer, then he was going to have to give up basketball.
I think with Coach Newell, he loved the game so much, and he was such a perfectionist. He wanted everything to be exactly right. And he made a wise decision, you know, in not coaching it anymore as far as a game is concerned, but coaching the people who coached the game and the people who played the game. He became the coach of the game. And to me, that was a wise decision on his part. And the game and all of us have benefited as a result of that decision.
I was an Olympic coach, and it was in Rome that year. So I had a wonderful experience as being a coach of a great team.
Pete Newell coached part of what may be the greatest collection of amateur basketball players ever to compete in international basketball.
Four of the players I had on my Olympic team were not only outstanding college players and very big names, Oscar Robertson, Jerry West, Jerry Lucas, and Walter Bellamy. And all four of those ex-players are in the Hall of Fame today.
Pete always had a strong feeling that the Olympic trials should contain a round-robin type tournament. And when we were there in 1960, it was the Army All-Stars, small college All-Stars, AAU teams, and so there was eight teams in it. And the NCAA champions, which was Ohio State that year, they had beaten us.
It was a very difficult, very tedious situation, and I'm sure it was very, very political because during those days, the AAU basketball controlled everything.
So we go into an eight-team round robin, and the winning team had up to seven players that would be named on the Olympic team, plus their coach would be the Olympic coach.
It was a very exciting period of my life, have a chance to play against the very best players. But more importantly, the competition was so good.
The first game we played in Denver, Jerry did not have a very good game. You know Jerry West as well as I do. He was my roommate for 4 years when I was with the Lakers. Jerry never had two games bad. Never had. He had a tough one, but he'd throw 45 at you the next night.
You know, you're constantly talking to yourself when you're an athlete. You're constantly talking, what do I need to do to get better? What am I going to have to do to be able to play more?
The play out there was, it was probably different. It was a little rough, you know, where guys push you and hold you and hit your elbow and bump you and you know, throw elbows at you and whatnot. If you're not used to doing that, you know, it messes up your game.
And then at one point during the tryouts, Jerry thought that it probably was best for him to go home, to leave the team, because he didn't feel like he was playing good enough to be part of this group.
So I didn't know it, but Jerry's out walking the streets in Denver at night. So Pete's out there walking, and he sees him. So Pete walked up, Jerry, what are you doing? Jerry hung his head. He said, Pete, I said, I didn't play very well. I said, I'm not going to make the team.
And Pete Newell said this to him, if you leave this team, I will leave this team.
Pete was a father figure to Jerry West, a father he really never had. And Jerry personally told me about some things that way, that how close he was to Pete.
And he just was a great self-made player and one of our all-time greatest. And he was a very humble person, too.
I think being around people who care, people who you can learn from, and really good teammates, those are the things that have probably left the longest standing impression in my life, the people that who maybe sacrificed some of their things that maybe they could have accomplished so our team could accomplish something and we could win.
We worked out at West Point before we left for the Olympics, and Coach Newell, he had the knack of just making everybody feel special and really knowing what your job was. Our Olympic team in 1960 was a very special team. They had some great players on the team. In fact, we had four NBA rookies a year on that team and could have had five. Oscar Robertson was rookie of the year, Jerry Lucas was rookie of the year, Walt Bellamy was rookie of the year, and then Terry Dissinger from Purdue was rookie of the year.
Nine of us played in the pros when we got back. You could not be a pro and play in the Olympics then. Now the crazy thing about it is two players that never made that team, Havlicek and Lenny Wilkins, they were alternates.
There's better basketball throughout the world now than it was back then, and we didn't have any trouble beating anybody. But Coach Newell prepared, and especially when we went up against Russia, we wanted to beat them pretty good. So it was a very special thing just to play in the Olympics. And then I never will forget it, the night that we won the final game and you were standing up on that podium and they put that gold medal around your neck. Oh man, that was the ultimate, that really was.
Even today, I've told everyone, it was highlighting my life as a basketball player to play on a gold medal winning team, particularly as an amateur.
We came from different parts of the country and played very well together, became very good friends.
Oscar Robertson and I were the co-captains. We had a chance to go up and receive the gold medal for our team. It was one of the truly exciting moments of my life. I wish people knew what that felt like, because we were so much more nationalistic than we are today.
Pete was no longer coaching, and Rennie Hararius was coaching the team, and they didn't do particularly well. There were so many problems for Pete there, and very tough to be involved in sports in any way. He was operating from no position of strength. He once told me that if you made a decision in those times, you were wrong, and if you didn't, you're still wrong.
And Berkeley Ferrara's reputation nowadays was a very conservative campus in the 30s and 40s and 50s, and then it's changed.
The free speech movement took place in 64, and Berkeley was pretty much the center of political unrest among the college campuses. It was a time of upheaval, and very necessary upheaval.
The faculty at Cal was fairly conservative, and they weren't ready for the changes either.
And so you had the clash of the old and the new, and Pete suddenly felt very old and out of place, and so did his basketball coach, Rennie Hararius.
When we had the problems at Cal, it was, in 1964, Mario Savio, and you had all the problems at Cal, and we just happened to be the victims of that situation.
From 66 to 70, that was an extremely turbulent time at Cal, and very tough to be involved in sports in any way, because there was so much, there was a time of a revolution.
I was there when they tear gassed the students on campus. I was there for People's Park. So it was a tough time for everybody.
What transpired was there was a cultural clash at the university. And you have to look at the university and see whether it was an instrument of change or a mirror of society. And at that particular time, the university was a mirror of society.
The people protesting against the war were right. The college students activating change were right. But you don't get right without making a big noise.
There were certain visionaries who were identifying some of these issues so that the university could address itself to it. Like for Jack Scott was one of the individuals who began to do something of that nature.
What you're seeing in the last few years, development of a counterculture in the United States, and this has begun to now influence athletes.
And the dynamics that existed at that particular time evolved into an athlete revolt.
So you see athletes wanting to have longer hair, wanting to dress a little freaky, and now getting involved, you know, in use of psychedelic drugs and other things, which, you know, puts coaches, you know, out of their mind. They can't handle that kind of stuff.
Jack Scott personified the voice of change, and he had the black athletes' attention, and he was taking them where they needed to go.
Jack was a student there, and he was working on his doctorate degree. And he began to teach at the university, and some of the athletes adopted some of those ideas.
When we had the problems at Cal, it was going to be a black rebellion in football. That's where it was going to start. And then it carried over to basketball.
Bob Presley was there, and all the other young players who were there at the time. And it just didn't work out smoothly.
They were excited about afros then, afro haircuts. Black pride.
These other young people now began to have, you know, their hairdos and their mustaches and their own particular cultural habits. And so when they were asked to make some kind of transition with it, they rejected it. And so that caused a confrontation and a problem.
And therefore, there were suspensions. There was, you know, guys kicked off the team for long hair or a comment.
And Presley became the scapegoat. And it wasn't an atmosphere conducive to winning.
The kids were making statements, and they were fostering change. And the change happened.
It was tougher on Rennie than it was on Pete, because Pete didn't have to deal with those issues as a coach.
The one thing that I do remember when my dad was at Cal and they went through that unrest, that social unrest that was going on. And somebody had accused him of being a racist.
It hurt him and it hurt me, and it hurt our families, and it hurt the whole program is what it hurt.
And I didn't think Pete was comfortable being AD at Cal. I thought it wasn't his calling. He wanted to deal with the sports program, and Cal was much more than that in those days.
And so I think it was at that time that he began to think of an alternative. And I remember my mom writing me and saying that I think we're going to go in a different direction.
One of the things I remember about expansion teams in the NBA is you don't have much to start with. And it's pretty difficult to be competitive when you are given, you know, kind of the 11th or 12th man on a roster.
Went to school at the University of Kentucky, and then all of a sudden I got drafted, you know, by the San Diego Rockets. And I was the number one draft pick that year, and Jack McMahon was the head coach. When Pete Newell came on, took some of the responsibilities off Jack from a general manager standpoint, and my opportunity to meet Pete Newell, the first day that I walked into his office, I knew this was a whole nother world.
When he came down to San Diego, I thought this was a really, really important coup for the San Diego team.
And he created the stability in the organization. We had drafted the second year, you know, when Pete got there, we drafted Elvin Hayes. And that just turned our whole franchise around. We went from a 15-win team to the playoffs.
As I recall in Phoenix, the more time I could spend with a guy like Pete Newell, the better off I was going to be. And that began a really, really personal relationship that lasted over 40 years.
I remember my rookie year, about halfway through the year, I went from being a bench player to getting into the starting lineup, and we went into the playoffs that year as the youngest team in professional sports. We had three rookies starting in the playoffs. We lost to the Atlanta Hawks.
Well, when I got to San Diego Rockets, the season already started. That had training camp season very early in the season. This was in 1969. And Jack McMahon was the coach, and he was relieved of his duties, and in came Alex Hannum, a legendary Hall of Fame coach. And that was my first year. And so we had an excellent draft that year. Drafted Rudy Tomjanovich, number one, Calvin Murphy, number two, who I'd played against in college. He played at Niagara. And one thing about him, you know, he saw something in some of these guys, and all they needed to do was work and work on some of their weaknesses.
And the guys that stayed with the team for the 3 years that I was there, we always found a place to go work out.
I first met Coach Newell when I was in high school. He was running the San Diego Rockets at the time, and I had a key to our gym, Helix High School, which was the best gym in all San Diego at the time. And the Rockets would come and play all the time, and the guys would call me up, and it was Elvin Hayes and Rudy Tomjanovich and Calvin Murphy and Pat Riley and Rick Adelman and Stu Lance and Don Kogis.
We would always meet, we'd always convene, and while the workouts weren't very organized, they were workouts where guys would get together. And a lot of that was fostered by, I think, the suggestion that Pete made to a lot of people that, look, you got to work out in the summertime, that this is not just, you know, 8 months and then, you know, take a vacation for five.
I remember my first real one-on-one type meeting with Pete, and it occurred after the season, my rookie year. I got a call from Pete like the day the season ended, and he says, can you come down to the office? And I'm thinking, uh-oh, now what did I do? And so I made sure I was down there in a heartbeat. And I walk into his office, and he says to me, you know, I thought you had a pretty good rookie year. I think you might be able to play a few years in this league if you work on a few things. So when Pete said, we need to work on some guard skills, I said, no problem. So he says to me, if you're willing, I'll work with you. And the very next morning, he said, I'll meet you at the University of San Diego, 8:00 in the morning. And we worked one-on-one just about every morning the rest of that summer.
Here's a general manager that was willing to put on the gym trunks and go work with these guys, you know, on their weaknesses and, you know, make them better players. Get out of his corporate white shirt, tie, and put on the gym trunks and go work with these guys to make them better players and to make his team a better team.
You know, when I came into the league, coaching was not very sophisticated. And so, you know, there was a need for more organization and more teaching, and then college coaches came into the game.
Mr. Newell had a great relationship with Tex Winter, and Tex was at the University of Washington, had great success at Kansas State, and kind of wanted to try pro ball. And Pete hired him, and so they came down, loved San Diego area. We had some meetings, and you know, everything was going great, and boom, we're sold.
The franchise was moved to Houston.
All of a sudden, the next thing I know, I'm on a plane going to Houston.
Rudy Tomjanovich and Calvin Murphy, those two guys, even after the franchise was moved to Houston, they were just synonymous with the Rockets because they played their entire careers for the Rockets. And it was special, but again, it was the foundation that enabled that franchise to go on to win championships.
When Pete got the Laker job, he was basically coming back home because he'd grown up in downtown L.A. And it brought back you know, all the colorful stories of his childhood. He was a child actor. Pete's mom had been a beauty queen. And when she got to Hollywood, she was fascinated with the whole scene and wanted her kids to be in the movies. And Pete was the natural choice there. And she pretty much railroaded him into being a child actor. And he did a bunch of films, usually kind of in the background. And Jackie Coogan was the big child actor at the time. And all the little kids had to have the Jackie Coogan haircut, which is this Prince Valiant looking thing. And he just absolutely hated it. He lost a big role to Jackie Coogan in a movie called The Kid. And upon losing that role, He's walking around with a Jackie Coogan haircut. Everybody's giving him grief on it. He got in more fights over that haircut and finally got out of acting. He was a scrapper. He was an operator. You know, he always came across as a really kind of a saintly guy.
Well, reuniting, you know, with Pete Newell in L.A. and also understanding what he had brought to the table in San Diego, that I knew it was a franchise that was steeped in tradition. Jerry West, Elgin Baylor, you know, the likes. I was a role player, and I was proud of that. I got into the rotation and became part of one of the greatest teams in the history of the game when we won 69 games and lost 13 and had a 33-game winning streak. Ended up winning the world championship that year, and so I felt extremely privileged to be part of that organization.
I think we all look at our careers and say, when were you at the peak of your career, when were you starting to decline? Well, I'd started to decline. I'd had some injuries that really, at that point in time, were very major. And Pete was constantly encouraging me, you know, this is going to get better, this is going to get better, this is going to get better. And that's when I think we really became extremely close. And if I had something bothering me, I could go talk to him, because I always felt I could do more to help us win.
I think Pete had recognized, you know, that, you know, Jerry, you know, was getting older and he was injured, and that it was time for them to become very proactive.
And Pete was very, very good at evaluating situations, not only the talent, but the situations to bring talent aboard. And so he was instrumental in dealing with Wayne Embry.
When I started moving in the NBA general manager circles, Pete Newell was the first to embrace me and make me feel comfortable at the league meetings, and he just kind of adopted me, which, you know, was a big relief, man. He just brought me right into the fold. We went on a lot of scouting trips together. It was a lot of time on the road.
You know, when you lose talent, the way the Lakers in that time frame lost talent in like three successive years, Jerry West lost, Elgin Baylor gone, Wilt Chamberlain gone, especially in the middle with Wilt, you start having to think about where you're going to go from there.
You know, so now they have to re-energize the Los Angeles Lakers, and everybody in the league wanted a strong Los Angeles Laker team.
On this eventful October evening, I get a call from Wes Pavilon, says Kareem wants to have a meeting. Sam Gilbert, his agent's coming to town, and they want to have a meeting. And sure enough, Kareem took us through the fact that he wanted to be traded. And so obviously that caused kind of a uproar in our organization. You know, fire the coach, fire Wayne, fire whomever, you know. We got to keep Kareem because he is the franchise, which he was.
One of the things that a general manager, you know, has to recognize, and that's why they're always criticized, because they have to learn how to keep their team one step ahead of the posse, you know, that's chasing them, everybody else in the league, and one step away from the street.
Oscar's gotten older, approaching retirement. Bobby Dandridge and Kareem can't carry this team. So we're going to have to redo it, because it's unfair for Kareem to stay here through that process, because, you know, we're going to have to start over. And then all of a sudden, late one afternoon, I get a call from Pete, and he says, do we have anything to talk about regarding Kareem? Pete wanted to give us Gail Goodrich in the deal. And I said, you know, I love Gail. He's obviously a future Hall of Famer, but Gail's 34 years old. That doesn't help me. I said, we'll do the deal if you give us Brian Winters. Brian was a rookie, and I liked him at South Carolina. Of course, so didn't Pete, because we saw a lot of them together. And so I said, key to this is we got to keep us quiet until we can put a deal in place.
The closed doors of the general manager's office doesn't get as much publicity as it maybe it should, because that's really where things take off.
New York came at us because they knew that that was a desirable place, and we said no. Not that your players weren't great, because they were, because they had won championships with Walt Frazier, Willis Reed, Phil Jackson, you know, the Buescher, that team had won championships, but they had also matured, grown in age. If we're going to start over, we got to get youth and as much quality as we can. We could come out of here with having a great player like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and come out of it with absolutely nothing.
I mean, it wasn't like there were a lot of places that Jabbar was willing to go. It might have been just New York and Los Angeles at the time. And LA had enough assets to talk about that would satisfy Milwaukee.
Pete was fascinated by Jack Kent Cook, who owned the Lakers. He was a brilliant man, Cook, and had incredible diction and was extremely well-read and spoke so well and was a fascinating guy, and Pete gave him that credit. So now it comes down to they've got a chance to make a big deal here. And they're going back and forth. All of a sudden, Cook's got a deal. He's negotiating with Portland personally. Bill Walton had played 1 year in Portland. They weren't crazy about him up there. He hadn't obviously won the title, long-haired hippie, whatever. And they actually had a deal for Walton. Meanwhile, Pete is negotiating for Kareem with Wayne Embry. If you knew him, you knew how it went down. But people didn't realize that he'd worked for 6 weeks on that deal. You know, between the big stars they had around there, Pete was just kind of a guy in the background, you know, moving the cars.
And I remember it was touch and go in the 70s for me as to whether I was going to remain on the Trailblazers or become a Laker. And Pete Newell, he knew from the very beginning that Kareem was the way to go.
And of course, that's one of the biggest deals of all time.
And with that, it gave us a foundation to build on. And we were able to build the Milwaukee Buck team for the 80s.
And you know, when Pete Newell brought us Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, you know, from Milwaukee, even though it took a lot of players to get him here, was really the start of the turnaround for the next dynasty, and that team becoming the team of the 80s.
It started very inauspiciously in that Coach Newell was working with Kermit Washington by himself over at this place called Rogers Park, which is in Englewood, basically down the street from the Forum, a little park gym. And Coach Newell knew my father and asked if I would come over and basically play defense against Kermit. And, you know, it was 2 hours of Kermit Washington and myself my freshman year at UCLA. And I was as really skinny college kid at that time. Going at it under Coach Newell's tutelage every other day, all summer.
Pete Newell to me was like a mentor for me. He lived around a corner from me, about a half a block away, Palos Verdes, and he was retiring, I think, as a general manager that year. And he worked me on my fundamentals, and then I just kept getting better and better as time went on. My stats went up from maybe 4 points a game or 5 points a game to almost 10 points and 10 rebounds a game.
And Kermit got together and talked about having a real basketball camp.
The first year was only two guys. And then we brought in, I think, Don Ford, Kenny Carr, and Tommy Abernathy. He grabbed them, and some of them started coming in.
And, you know, we moved around a little bit. We went over to Loyola.
So it just kept getting bigger, and then they start rolling in from everywhere.
When I was at UCLA, I knew who Pete Newell was, and I know that Kermit Washington and Kiki Vanderway were two of the main guys that really got things started for the big man camp with Pete Newell. But in those days, I knew that was happening, and I would go down, because it was in the Los Angeles area, I would go down and watch.
Basically, for a time, every NBA big man came through this camp. If it was any good. And, you know, you just go ahead and name them all. They all went through the camp.
The guys that came there were just tough guys, and they were ready to do battle every day. And so you came there, was no whistles, no referees. You would get beat down in the ground.
And you didn't get paid for any of this. You know, it was all free. Everyone could come. You just had to come and you know, give effort. And he wanted to help you.
It got to a point where I think he had as many as 200 or 300 players who had been there in a 5-year span.
Pete was the first one to open up the minds of a lot of executives and coaches in the NBA that you need to work with your players. And if you want to get better, here I am.
We had many Laker players to go to his camp, and of course, Dane Worthy and Kurt Rambis too, particularly early on when Pete first started his camp.
I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that when players want to get better, any player that spends the time doing the right things to get better during the offseason, those are the players that you want on your team.
The best players in the NBA, the big guys, wanted to go to Coach Newell's camp because they knew he was the best teacher and they respected him so much.
I can remember times where, for example, Bernard King came to the workouts and he couldn't get a move correctly one time. And he probably went through it 12 times with Bernard. But he wanted Bernard King to understand the move, and Bernard was excited about it. And you could just see that specific time where you had a great player and a great coach. And it was just a very special moment that really, I think, typified what it's all about.
And guys that had been to the camp worked with guys that were new, also stood on the sidelines and worked with guys. So it was a unique environment to have players working with other players from another team, trying to help everybody get better.
After being with the Buffalo Braves, Buffalo moved to San Diego and we became the Clippers. And Kermit Washington became our teammate, and he knew Pete and started working with him. So Kermit and I living down in San Diego, he invited me up. He said, you got to work with Pete, man. He's working on footwork. It's good for you. And footwork is, you know, it's a no-brainer. It's a better season. It's a better team season and possibly a better contract the next one.
Players really didn't learn post-play as we did because coaches didn't teach it. And he would teach post moves, but he would take it a step further. The counters and the counters to the counters.
I think Kiki had the best footwork of any player that ever came, him and Purvis Short. Those two, I think, had the best footwork or were Pete Newell's best students of learning his techniques.
Kiki and Coach Newell was basically a basketball father-son relationship. And to have the Kiki moves, a move named after him, that was all a product of Pete Newell.
And a lot of the different moves and things have become standard, sort of standard operating procedure in the NBA.
He wanted a big guy to be a student of the game, not to just be this big Hulk who sets screens and rebounds and block shots, but there was a science there.
He was also interested in pushing the evolution of the game to its highest levels. Going to Pete Newell's camp was like getting a PhD in life.
I got the job with ESPN, and I originally went on assignment. But after the first taste, I would spend the whole year trying to figure out how I was going to tell my editors that I needed to be back there again. I didn't know what the player was that was going to sell it. I didn't know what the storyline was going to be. But here's the truth of it. I was there because of the relationships I developed, because of the basketball knowledge, and because I was being introduced and accepted into a community of basketball.
So the development of, you name it, the Shaquille O'Neals, Elijah Wans, a whole host of centers who have gone on to become Hall of Famers came through Pete Newell's big man's camp.
From 1959 to 1980, in the NBA, there were 21 MVPs. And in those 21 years, 20 of them were centers. Today, there's no center that's even close to being the MVP.
Years ago, the center was a key for your offense. The ball went in, and you cut, and you picked. You either cut down or picked on the forward, cut through. But now you don't have that anymore. You never throw a ball to the pivot. If you came on the scene and you could make jump shots all over the place, boy, that's all they let you do, shoot jump shots. You don't have any picks, any triangle-type offense. You don't have double screens, reverses, swing the ball to the weak side. Because the coaches didn't know how to do that.
In today's world that we're in, coaches don't have near the time to to teach and coach their teams that we did at those early years. And one of the problems I have in basketball today is a lack of teaching. Our coaches today, from high school on up, for the most part, are not that involved in the teaching part. And to me, it's so, so important in coaching that you try to learn how to teach. And if you're teaching, you'll understand that the why of what you're asking a player to do is maybe more important than the technique of what you're explaining. Because if a player understands why he's doing something, he'll probably do it more naturally. It may not be exactly as you, the coach, has described it to him, but in his own way, he'll get it done because he understands why he has to do it.
There was one conversation in particular that I remember with Coach Newell, and he was talking about the concerns he had with international basketball and the future of USA basketball. He really felt that the rest of the world was catching up to the U.S. in its style of play in basketball and would ultimately pass them by. He felt the game was overcoached in terms of strategy and tactics, but it wasn't being taught the appropriate way on the individual level.
And I think it's going to change because they made Jerry Colangelo, a very, very knowledgeable man in basketball, president of the basketball team, and he is now head of our international program.
One of the most important things I think you get from mentors, you know, is the opportunity to, you know, speak with them firsthand, and you have to have somebody who's going to nurture you and that you can listen to, that you really believe is sincere and competent and reliable. So when I became an assistant coach with the Lakers, two of the greatest voices in my life at that time, as far as my coaching philosophy or the development of my philosophy, was Pete Newell and Bobby Knight.
Of course, Bobby was kind of a Pete Newell disciple, defensively orientated, tough-minded team. And I mean, there are some funny stories concerning the two of those guys.
I used to go to these clinics, and I remember the clinics that they had, you know, down in Long Beach or down in Orange Coast or wherever they were, and I can remember Pete. I'd call Pete and I'd say, Pete, I'd like to come to the clinic. He said, just make sure you bring a pad and pencil with you, you know, and because Coach Knight is not going to want to see anybody sitting up there in the stands, you know, like this.
I'll tell you, his relationship with Pete Newell was amazing. He loved him. He spoke with him all the time. He depended on him. And that's one of the more unique, amazing, wonderful relationships that I've seen in my experience in life, not just in basketball.
Another thing to show you how special that relationship is, when Coach Knight was inducted into the Basketball Hall of Fame in Springfield, Massachusetts, he chose Pete Newell to be his presenter.
Yeah, they were like father and son. And so a lot of times Coach Newell came and visited Coach Knight, and as a result, I met Coach Newell and developed my own relationship, which lasted well over a quarter of a century. So I've taken many things from Coach Newell, but the main thing was his friendship. As I came up the ranks, as we built our program at Duke, you know, Coach Newell gave me insights every year. I always asked his opinion, you know, and he was able to figure out what you could learn and then your capacity to do. That's an interesting combination. And that's what he was good at, trying to figure out, okay, here's the talent you have. Let's see what your capacity to learn is. And putting those things together is what made him unique.
Pete Newell had great confidence in me to carry on what was good for the game. I remember being in New York with Commissioner Stern one day, and I said, I think we got to change the rules. Because if I get turned off on the game, we got a problem, because I love the game. He said, well, what do you think needs to be done? I said, we have to speed up the game, we have to clean up the game, we have to do away with the isolation, we have to make it clear for people to understand what the rules are defensively. What are the defensive guidelines? Everyone's guessing. He said, well, go ahead. So I appointed a committee. I met with Pete. What do you think? Here's what I think. And so Pete came in to visit with me, came into Phoenix. We spent about 4 hours one day. Suns had a home game that night. He went back to the hotel to rest, came back for the game. He said, I'll leave something for you. And I'm leaving early in the morning. I'll leave you a written, you know, like some notes. And to this day, I still have this document because he wrote about 12 pages.
My relationship with Pete was like, you know, father, daughter. I mean, I just loved him to death. And when I would go to the big man camp and watch, and I'd ask Pete, why are you not doing this for the women? And I pestered him. I got on him about it. And certainly with Pete Jr. and then Bill McClintock, we eventually did do that for the women. The WNBA had already started, and we had thought that that was, again, a great transition for not only the college kids, but also the WNBA players. And Pete loved being involved with women because it was such a different level. And he was really refreshed by the intensity that we brought out onto the court on each drill.
Pete left the Lakers organization and went to the Warriors for a little while with Franklin Muley. And Al Addles was, of course, coaching. And then things changed there, and he became available. And when I took the job in Cleveland in 1986, I made a place for Pete Newell. I wanted him on my staff as a consultant. He could live in LA, and I just had so much respect for his knowledge of the game of basketball and how he had helped everybody.
His whole life was sports, and it gave him something to live for, and he always lived for the big man's camp. And as soon as it got early to spring, he would start talking to Merv Lopes and how many guys are coming to the big man's camp, and you know, where are we going to have it this year, and who's showing up, and who's sending players. And it would excite him and make him enthusiastic about every day. And after the big man's camp was over, then he'd come back, we'd go to Del Mar races. When Del Mar was over, the football season would be starting. As soon as that was over, basketball would be starting. And so he got on this routine where something would always be out in front of him that he could anticipate. It kept him going. And he interspersed basketball interests and all the people that would call him for advice and consultation from, you know, it could have been Jerry West calling when he was general manager, talking about some big man that they might consider drafting, or whether it would be Jerry Colangelo. And Bobby would call him, and Mike Krzyzewski would call him. He had a lot of people that valued his opinion, and he always gave it freely.
This is a guy who could have made a ton of money being who he was. He could have been a circuit speaker, he could have sold his program, he could have done camps galore, and he never, it was never about the money. One of the saddest experiences for me was going to the last Pete Newell big man camp in Hawaii. Anybody working in the NBA was no longer allowed to be involved in the Pete Newell camp. It just became a college camp. The reason that was such a loss to me is because if you're around the NBA, it is about money. It is about prestige. It is about power. And this was the one place you went to where you saw pros, players, and coaches. And it wasn't about money. And it wasn't about stats. It wasn't about any of that. It was back to the purity of basketball.
The footprint that Coach Newell left on our game at every level is a huge footprint. And it'll never go away.
The path that he blazed is second to none in the history of basketball.
Coach Newell is the history of basketball. This was a guy who brought so many of the concepts that we have today to the game.
I believe he's sort of one of the saints of basketball because he had this higher calling. And to be able to achieve that, it couldn't be about Pete Newell.
He was such a reservoir of information for me. And when he spoke, I listened because there was something that I was going to learn from that time and that conversation together. You know, I've never been big in my life to say I had 14 mentors or 6 mentors. The closest thing I've ever had to a mentor would be Pete Newell. He was so excited that I was given that opportunity to take over USA Basketball because he believed that I would get the job done.
Pete Newell, in my mind, should take Jimmy Stewart's place in What a Wonderful Life. Pete will never know how much he's done, just not only for me, but for hundreds of other players, and their lives are better because of him.
And when you look back on this, you're going to find Pete just woven through every principle, you know, that's been taught.
I gotta be honest, I don't feel like Pete is really gone. Because when I see Kiki, I see Pete. When I see Rick Carlisle, Mark Ivoroni, when I see them, the first thing I think of is Pete Newell. Because there's a piece of him in them.
I've often said that the people who leave legacies are the ones, the great painters, great writers, great musicians, the great speakers. Pete Newell had kind of all of those things. And yet somewhere along the way, he will be forgotten, but not by those who really cared about him.
Well, our final inductee possesses all the qualities that make that special title coach so endearing. Ladies and gentlemen, there are so many people in his 92 years that Coach Newell has touched, and one of them joins us tonight. And he's here because he loves this man, Pete Newell. Welcome to San Diego, Bob Knight.
I don't think there has been anyone that has contributed more to basketball over a longer period of time than Pete Newell has. And really, the game has never caught up with Pete's ideas and thoughts about the game. They say for most of us in coaching, the game has passed us by. The game has never caught up to Pete. The best compliment that I ever received as a coach came from Jerry West. He was a member of Pete's 1960 Olympic team, and he was discussing Pete's team on which he played and the team that I coached in 1984 on which Michael Jordan played. And Jerry started out his comparison of these two U.S. Olympic gold medal teams by saying that it was essentially the same person coaching both teams. And I have never received a better compliment than that. And for those of us that have been fortunate enough to coach the game of basketball, this man has meant more to us than anyone that has ever touched the game. The shadow that he cast over college basketball is the greatest of all.